Good afternoon, dear students. I welcome you all for this third lecture on Fundamental of Systematics. In this pandemic of Corona, I hope you all are safe at your home. Today, we are going to discuss the third topic of our syllabus, that is biological classification. So today's lecture number 3, biological classification. So as we all have already studied in last lecture, what is mean by classification, systematics, as well as history of taxonomy and systematics. So we all know that in general, classification means general arrangement of objects or things in different groups based on certain similarities. On the other hand, when we apply this term for biological classification, it is nothing but a proper scientific procedure which involves organizing organisms into different groups and subgroups based on certain similarities and differences or dissimilarities. Now, we have also seen why there is a need of this taxonomy and different systems of classification, because there is enormous diversity of living organism on this earth. It is estimated earlier that around 3 million to 100 million species could be living onto this earth. However, recent research paper published in 2011 states that there are around 8.7 million species which are living on earth. And out of that, 6.5 million species live on land and 2.2 million species, they live in the oceans. So, we have already studied the history of taxonomy, where we have come across the contribution of great Aristotle. He was the first one to attempt the scientific classification, and he has given the backbone framework for the basis of classification. He used simple morphological characters for classifying the living organisms. So plants were classified simply into three groups like trees, shrubs and herbs, whereas animals were classified based on presence of blood into two groups like inamia and anemia. On the other hand, based on the type of birth, organisms were classified into oviparry, that is egg-laying animals, and viviparry, that is the animals which are directly giving birth to the young ones. Now, the first question that arises, why there is need for the classification of living organisms? So we all know the enormous diversity of living organisms. It is very essential to identify and describe all these possible type of species which are living on earth. Secondly, to arrange these species in various categories or groups on the basis of similarities and dissimilarities they share. The taxonomy or classification systems help in the easy identification of organisms. Next, all kinds of organisms do not occur in the same locality, so it becomes imperative to have a proper classification system. Then, the study of one or the two organisms is not sufficient to know the essential features of a particular group of organisms. Classification helps in knowing the relationships. Now, very importantly, there are different types of relationships two organisms can share. So, classification system helps in understanding such relationships between different groups of organisms. Very importantly, it helps us to know the evolutionary relationship between different organisms. Now, over the historical period of time, there are different types of classification system which were proposed by different taxonomists. So, the first system which was proposed was known as two kingdom classification system. Then come the three kingdom classification system, followed by four kingdom classification system, five kingdom classification system, and then most recently the six kingdom classification system or the three domain classification system has been proposed. So today we are just going to focus on the first two classification system, that is two kingdom classification system and the three kingdom classification system. So the first system, that is two kingdom classification system, was proposed by the great taxonomist Carolus Linnaeus in the year 1758. So we have already seen that Carolus Linnaeus is also known as a father of taxonomy, and he divided entire life into two domains, or rather two kingdoms. So these two kingdoms were named as Kingdom Plantae and Kingdom Animalia. So what these two kingdoms comprises of? The first kingdom, that is Kingdom Plantae, it comprises of all the bacteria, mycoplasma, fungi and all photosynthetic plants. On the other hand, the second kingdom comprises of all the unicellular and multicellular animals. Now in the next slide, we'll see in more detail. So the two kingdom system, Plantae kingdom comprising algae, fungi, bacteria, bryophytes, pteridophytes and all the spermatophyta. On other hand, Kingdom Animalia comprising all the animals, maybe vertebrates or invertebrates, all were grouped together. So coelenterates, porifera, platyhelminths, mollusks, nematihelminthes, annelida, echinodermata and all the chordates, they were all clubbed together into the single kingdom, that is Kingdom Animalia. Now we see the features which were proposed for these two kingdom classification system. So first we'll look at the features of Kingdom Plantae. So according to Linnaeus, all the organisms which are belonging to the Kingdom Plantae, they should possess cell wall, they should be autotrophic, that is they should be able to produce their own food. The reserve food which is produced by them should be in the form of starch. They should have a big central vacuole present in the cell. Then all these organisms belonging to the Kingdom Plantae, they lack certain important organs or systems like excretory organs, nervous system, absence of any sense organs and muscular system. Then when we see the locomotion in such organisms, so they lack locomotion. So no locomotion is seen in these organisms belonging to the Kingdom Plantae. They absorb all the inorganic nutrients from the outside environment and they experience unlimited growth. So there is no limit to their growth. They keep on growing over the period of time. And they show response to the external stimuli, but in very slow manner. So all these were the features of Kingdom Plantae. Now we move on to the features of the Kingdom Animalia. So according to the Linnaeus two kingdom classification system, all organisms belonging to the Kingdom Animalia have, or rather they lack the presence of cell wall. The inorganic crystals are absent in their cells. The central vacuoles is also absent in the cell. Their growth is limited up to a particular period of time, and then the growth ceases. They show heterotrophic mode of nutrition, that means they are dependent on the other living organisms for their food and nutrition. Opposite to the Kingdom Plantae, they show very quick responses to the external stimuli. Also, they show a very well developed muscular system, locomotion is well developed. Then certain organs and systems like excretory organs, nervous system, sense organ, which were not well developed in Kingdom Plantae are quite well developed in the Kingdom Animalia. On contrary to the reserve food in the form of starch in plants, here the reserve food in Kingdom Animalia is in the form of glycogen. However, this system, which was proposed by Carlos Linnaeus, come across certain demerits or limitations. So what are those demerits or limitation of this system? We'll see. This system did not indicate any evolutionary relationship between plants and animals, because as we know, the evolutionary theory, which was proposed by Darwin later in 19th century. So until this time, the evolutionary relationship was not well established. So he was unable to explain anything about the evolutionary relationship between plants and animals. Then it had certain lacunae, like he groups all the prokaryotes and eukaryotes together. Also, all the unicellular and multicellular organisms were also grouped together. There was no distinction between the heterotrophic fungi and autotrophic green plants, because the fungi and green plants were clubbed together into single kingdom, that is the Kingdom Plantae. Then there was certain organisms like Euglena and lichens, so they were not grouped into any of the kingdom, neither in the Kingdom Plantae nor in the Kingdom Animalia. Slime mold, a type of fungi, was neither grouped in fungi nor it was grouped into the plants. The reason for that was given is it was wall-less and holozoic in vegetative stage, and it develops cell wall in the reproductive stage. Then there was, in this classification system, there was no classification of viruses and other viroids. So this two kingdom system was later replaced by another system, that is three kingdom classification system. So this three kingdom classification system was proposed in the year 1866 by Ernst Haeckel. In this, he proposed a third kingdom, that is Kingdom Protista. So now the three kingdom comprises of Kingdom Protista, including unicellular organisms, Kingdom Plantae, including all plants, and Kingdom Animalia, including all animals. So why this third kingdom was established? So as to encompass the all the remaining organisms which were not covered as per the previous two kingdom classification system. So this group included all algae, fungi, and protozoans which are unicellular. However, in the latter classification system, we'll see that this Protista was reserved only for the unicellular organisms. So three kingdom classification system we'll see in more detail here with the help of this chart. So Haeckel classified all the living organisms on the basis of either unicellularity and multicellularity. So this was the only criteria he taken into consideration, and he classified all the living organism in three kingdoms. So kingdom first, that is Protista, he included all the unicellular algae, fungi, and bacteria. Second kingdom, that is Kingdom Plantae, also referred to as Metaphyta, that means multicellular plants. Third kingdom, that is Kingdom Animalia, also referred to as Metazoans, that means multicellular animals. So the arrangement of kingdoms was done on the basis of certain characteristics in this three kingdom classification system. So what are those characters? First, morphological complexities and presence or absence of tissue system, division of labor, mode of nutrition, All the unicellular animals like algae and fungi, they were separated from other organisms into the third kingdom, that is kingdom Protista, based on the lack of tissue differentiation. So now this three kingdom classification system, which was proposed, has also faced certain limitations or demerits. So what were those? We'll see in this final slide. So in this three kingdom classification system also, there was no separation of prokaryotes and eukaryotes. So both of them were classified together. They were not divided into different kingdoms. Similarly, even unicellular and multicellular were organisms together under kingdom Protista, because though fungi was classified into the kingdom Protista, there was no distinction made between the unicellular fungi and multicellular fungi. So this Haeckel system was not readily accepted worldwide, and also it faced certain demerits, like all the microorganisms were classified along with fungi and animals like protozoans in the kingdom Protista. Similarly, all nucleated and unnucleated organisms were kept together in the kingdom Protista, and heterotrophic bacteria and fungi were placed along with the autotrophic fungi. So there was no distinction made between the heterotrophic organisms and the autotrophic organisms. So these were the lacunae of the third kingdom or the three kingdom system classification proposed by Haeckel. So with this, we will have a quick overview of today's topic. So today we discuss about biological classification. In this, we understood what is mean by biological classification, that nothing but arrangement of organisms into the hierarchical series of groups and subgroups based on certain similarities and differences. We understood the need of the classification system because there is an enormous diversity of living organisms. Some 8.7 million species have been estimated to be present onto the Earth globe. We understood the contribution of Aristotle, though he does not propose any classification system, but he gave the basis for the scientific classification system based on which other classification systems have developed over the period of time. Then we understood need of the classification, not only the diversity we need to encompass it into the classification, but to arrange them in probable groups, as well as easy identification of organism, and help understand various types of relationship like evolutionary relationships between the living organisms. Then today we discuss two classification system. First, that is two kingdom classification system, and the three kingdom classification system. So two kingdom classification system proposed by Carlos Linnaeus, he just grouped them into two kingdoms, that is kingdom Plantae and kingdom Animalia. So it included, the kingdom Plantae included algae, fungi, bacteria and all the higher plants, whereas kingdom Animalia included all the chordates and non-chordates. So there was no clear-cut distinction. Then we understood what were the features of the kingdom Plantae and what were the features proposed for the kingdom Animalia. We looked at the demerits or the limitations of theory of two kingdom classification system. Then we looked at the three kingdom classification system proposed by Haeckel, where he proposed the third kingdom, that is kingdom Protista. And in this third kingdom, he included all the algae, fungi and bacteria. We understood what were the criteria which were taken into the consideration by Haeckel in this three kingdom classification system. And finally, we looked at the limitations of the three kingdom classification system proposed by Ernst Haeckel. So with this, we conclude this third lecture on fundamental of systematics. Thank you so much for your patience hearing.